announcements. So our SI times are listed here. Renee's voice is pretty shallow. She's losing her voice, so write these down here. The SI times tonight are tomorrow rather, 1 to 2 p.m. Biology 224. And then next week, Monday and Tuesday. So Monday 2 to 3, and Tuesday there's two time slots, 1 to 2 and 6:30 to 7:30 p.m. Okay? If you look at the syllabus, we're kind of tracking here pretty well. We've got the cancer lecture today. This week we're in cancer as a pathology. Next week we're in endocrine disorders. And then the week after that we have veterans week off, essentially, right? Because we're so patriotic, we just take the whole week off as a class. That's the way we roll, okay? We love our veterans so much. And then the week following Veterans Week is actually our second exam. Okay? Questions about that? All right. Any other comments or questions about how things are going? You guys want the fan on or off? On? It's going to be like 60-40, watch. And then we'll, when your faces start turning blue, I'll turn the fan off. How's that? Okay. What kind of fruit has the most electricity in it? What kind of fruit has the most electricity in it? A watt or melon? Why are animals in the ocean so healthy? Why are animals in the ocean so healthy? Because they get their daily dose of vitamin C. Okay. You guys need one more?
Yeah.
Is it? It's like Monday on a Wednesday.
Yeah.
All right. Why did the detective stay in bed? Maybe that's you, detective. Why did the detective stay in bed? He wanted to stay undercover. All right. We're gonna get some snow, I think, next week. If everything goes well, maybe it'll Friday, I don't know, but I think it's just gonna rain. It's gonna be cold enough. But let's kind of focus on today. Cancer. This lecture tends to be a fairly interesting lecture for most students. And I think it has a lot to do with the fact that many of us have a close loved one that has wrestled with some type of cancer, okay? Maybe you've lost somebody that's close to you as a result of that. You know, maybe somebody's actively working through their battle with cancer. Of course, this is Breast Cancer Awareness Month, which is kind of interesting. So we're like actually kind of on the theme, we're wrapping up the month with our cancer lecture. We'll talk a little bit about breast cancer today. But again, my caveat is, am I going to be able to provide you in 2 hours with everything that you might want to know about cancer, or everything that's out there? Absolutely not. This is a general pathology class. That's the title. It's a 300-level class, and the whole goal of this course is to expose you to certain things, so that when you move on in your field of study, you've got sort of a broad frame of reference of where all these pieces of the puzzle fit together. Inevitably, there's some students that come out of this lecture thinking, like, oh man, I think I'm going to be an oncologist now. Like, this is super fascinating to me. There are other people that, you know, make phone calls or they start realizing, oh, well, that explains a lot. So it's kind of an impactful lecture. Of course, I fit right in with that. I mean, we've got close friends and family members that have wrestled with cancer, that we've lost, you know, from cancer. Cancer is a pretty fascinating pathology. In fact, I was talking with a student, one of your colleagues, just yesterday about the difference between this course, the pathology and infectious disease, right? A different course. And I couldn't stop thinking about it last night. So you know who you are. Thanks a lot. But it was such an interesting question that was being posed. And so my answer that I gave your colleague was, well, we talk about things here really that you can't necessarily catch. They're not communicable. There's not usually an infectious agent. That's probably about 90% of the case in the pathology course that we cover. Now, we did cover HIV, and we'll talk about, you know, some other types of viruses that actually lead to cancer or cancerous conditions. And so that's still probably true. About 10% of what we cover in this class might be an infectious type of agent that causes the pathology. Usually, in general pathology, we're talking about disease states that are brought on due to other causes. There's immune compromisation that takes place. Okay, there's something trauma to the tissue, and then it results in a pathologic condition. So, if you're trying to make some decisions about what other classes to take, I think infectious disease is going to be quite interesting for you, or maybe you've already taken it. And it's sort of the other side of the equation. And it's very complementary in this class, where you're starting to think about things that can pass through populations. Like, we really don't cover the flu, right? It is an infectious disease, the flu. So we cover a couple of them, but we don't cover all of it. So, you know, the cool thing about what you're doing right now in your course of study is you're starting to kind of figure out what pathway you want to take. And I think the danger that we do is that we make you feel like you've got to figure out what you want to be for the rest of your life before you get your bachelor's. Okay? Or another way of saying is, what do you want to be when you grow up? Well, I think I'm still trying to figure out what I want to be when I grow up. Okay? I just hope I don't grow up too fast because I don't know yet. But, following what you're passionate about is probably the most important thing. And so if cancer biology or the field of cancer is fascinating to you, then maybe you want to explore that a little bit. If infectious diseases are a little bit more interesting to you, maybe you want to explore that. Okay? And that is really ultimately the beauty of the way the educational system is set up. It's not perfect. There's all sorts of problems with it. But the whole idea is to try to give you wide exposure as an undergrad. And that's why there's a lot of these general ed types of courses. Because if you never tried them, you may not know that you like them. Okay? So this is one that either it's on your radar with cancer or it's not, and it's going to become part of your radar. But this is not an infectious disease. If I'm struggling with cancer or battling cancer in my body, I am not risky to any of you. You can't catch it. And likewise, if you have cancer or wrestling with cancer or your neighbor is, sitting in close proximity is no big deal. So cancer is a mutation at the fundamental level of your own cells. And there is a process that goes awry. Most commonly, it has to do with mitotic division. And so the cells decide that they're going to deviate from normal cell cycle checkpoints, and that's what we're going to talk about today. And so this idea of general bio classes of looking at gap one, gap two, the mitotic phase, right, looking at the onion slices and figuring out what phase it's in, whether it's anaphase or prophase, you're like, I don't care about onions, I don't even like them. Well, it's all of that pre-rec stuff you have to take, because if you don't, you won't really appreciate the lecture we're about to have. So you can thank your onion instructor, okay? You send a message to your bio 181 or 182 TA and say, hey, you know, we're just in this cancer lecture, and I just want to say thanks for explaining stuff so well, because I actually do remember back to the cell cycle, and it actually is very relevant. So when your cells are exposed to mutagens, and they're exposed to mutagens all day long. Right now, they're being exposed to mutagens. Okay? You probably had some for lunch. It's probably sitting in your coffee cup. Okay? If you use a sweetener, there's definitely a potential mutagen sitting in your coffee cup. Right? So, oh my gosh, we shouldn't have any sweeteners, right? We should only have sugar. Now you got struggles with diabetes later in life, so you don't everything will eventually kill you, right? It's just sort of a pick your poison. But the reality is, if your cells are exposed to mutagens and the normal safety mechanisms that are in that are there in order to find where the damage is in the DNA and then pause replication to correct it, if that doesn't happen like it does normally all day long, then that cell deviates from normal cell cycle and it's acting autonomously by itself. And that's like one of the fundamental base principles of a cell becoming cancerous, is they start behaving on their own. Autonomy. Autonomy is, I make my own decisions, right? I'm waiting for my teenage daughter to say that. I'm sure it'll come, okay? But maybe it'll come in a different way. It'll probably be some sort of, you know, right? So autonomy is where the cells make a decision all by themselves, and they deviate from the normal cell cycle checkpoints, okay? And we'll build up. This is sort of my introductory pitch to kind of get us ready and wound up for what we're going to talk about today. So what is cancer? It's not some virus. It's not, although certain viruses can lead to a cancer situation, and we'll talk about that. Also, certain disease states, like an infection, can lead to a cancerous situation. In the very beginning of the semester, backtracking all the way to the beginning of the semester, we talked about an inflammatory situation, if left untreated and chronic, would lead to a cancer situation in the esophagus. And what was that disease? Barrett's esophagus, right? And this is where you've got stomach acid coming up, causing irritation to the lining of the esophagus. It goes through metaplasia, changes to a different cell type. If the harmful agent goes away, then it reverses back to its normal phenotype. But if the harmful agent stays in place because the 45-year-old white male is sort of stubborn and doesn't think there's anything wrong and never goes to see the doctor, 20 years of heartburn, now all of a sudden they start developing these lesions, which are esophageal adenocarcinomas. And so you have an inflammatory event that just led to cancer. You follow that? So there are connections that can be made between chronic damage or irritation to a tissue leading to a mutation at the level of the genes, and the DNA actually is compromised, and now that cell does whatever it wants. It stops behaving the way it normally should. And so what it does is it replicates out of control. Uncontrolled cell growth. It's one of the biggest tenets of cancer. And then we have a growth or a tumor, or what we call a neoplasm, a new growth. Neo meaning new. And this neoplasm that develops, we call it a dysplastic neoplasm. Dysplasia is a word that means malformed, because it's a new growth of something that's not supposed to be there. And if the last time you went to the dentist, okay, I know there's future dentists, there's future dental hygiene, and they do an oral exam, right? So they they ask about your summer vacation, right? While oh, really? Wow, so Disneyland was fun, huh? How expensive was it? Wow, they've raised prices, huh? You're like, what? How did they know what I just said? So they're much better now. It must be a course in dental hygiene school about how to interpret, right? You stand there with your lab partner, you hold each other's tongues, and you have this conversation, right? So if that's not the case, let me know when you guys graduate. I'll come get my teeth cleaned. Okay, I'll tell you about my summer vacation. You can interpret. And tell me about that class, because I'm super curious as to how you guys figure that out. But they do this oral exam because they're looking for growths within the oral cavity or on the tongue or under the tongue. And those are growths that aren't supposed to be there. There's a normal border of where cells are supposed to grow too. And so these malformed new growths, which is how this translates in the Latin, malformed new growth isn't supposed to be there. So here's a picture. Here's a picture here that shows this is the gut in the intestine. And you can see that the normal epithelium in this columnar organization now all of a sudden starts having some cellular growth that's out of the ordinary. It's not following this normal shape. And this is the dysplasia that we will see. And then at some point, you'll have this new growth, this in situ means in location, new growth grows outside of those borders. And if it becomes invasive, you can see here how it's punctured through the muscle layer. And this is where it starts becoming dangerous, because now you have these cells that have mutated and are starting to migrate to other locations. Okay? So this is kind of how cancer comes about. Now, it's more common that as we get older and the DNA becomes a little weaker and less able to repair itself, we'll talk about that later, that cancer incidents go up. But it doesn't mean, of course, there aren't pediatric cases of cancer. We all know that that's the case. Okay? But the incidence of cancer does tend to rise as we get older. Okay? You don't see nearly as many children suffering as with various types of cancer as you do with older geriatric populations. Okay? Now, there are two types of growth. We have one that we would consider to be benign, and we have one that we would consider to be malignant. Now, who can define the big difference between the two? Benign is what? Pardon? Non-cancerous is benign. What else? Localized, very good. What else? Has very well-defined borders. This is sort of a pop quiz to see if you looked at the slides ahead of time. Okay, nice and done so far. You could read the next slide and get all the answers, right? What else? What are some characteristics of malignant? It metastasizes. What does that mean? It spreads into another location, okay? So this is a, I think, a pretty helpful slide for a couple of reasons. It's a cartoon, right? It's a schematic or a drawing. And this is looking at the uterus. And you're looking at the endometrial lining of the uterus here. And this is a biopsy schematic, a cartoon drawing. On the left side would be a tumor or a neoplastic growth that would be considered benign. This is where your colleagues are getting all these terms from. It's slow growing. This benign lesion here, this leiomyoma, that's found in the smooth muscle lining of the uterus or uterine wall, has a very well-defined border. You can kind of, you can trace it if you wanted to, right? I could have my six-year-old actually trace this and say it was surgical preparation, right? Well-defined border, non-invasive. That means it's not going to invade another tissue. It's going to stay in that location. We don't see a metastatic branch. It doesn't break off and go somewhere else. We typically don't refer to this as cancer. It's considered a precancer, okay? The analogy would be, you know, someone said, oh, so-and-so's got, they're worried about skin cancer, they did a biopsy, it came back negative. It's not cancerous, it's just sort of a lesion, they're not worried about it. They're going to watch it, or maybe they did cut it off, right? And they're just going to keep an eye on it. So that would be this situation. If you look at the biopsy, you can see that it actually looks very much like smooth muscle. So the cells remain very well differentiated. They look like the tissue that they're supposed to look like in a benign tumor. Now, if you contrast that with the right side of the slide, this would be the slide on the right would be malignant. You can see that it's very rapidly growing, has a high mitotic rate. There's a relatively undefined border, meaning it'd be more difficult for someone to trace what that cancerous tissue margin was. In fact, this is one of the reasons surgically that they're so dangerous, is when you come in to remove this, you know, you would cut around this. Now, what do you do up here? You know, it's pumpkin carving time soon. So how are you going to do this? You're going to come up here, well, you're going to cut around this, and you're going to take what we call healthy margin with it. And they say, you know, what do you think about the outcome, doc? You know, how did it look? Well, you know what? It was pretty well defined, pretty very much localized, and I feel like I was able really to get all of it. right? Have you heard that terminology before? Like, I think I got all of it. That's what they're talking about is, if it has a well-defined border and they cut out around it, then they feel pretty confident that they removed all of the questionable tissue, and it's unlikely, they feel, at some percent success, right? And they never say 100%, right? They say, I think it's about, you know, I'm about 97% confident. Like, where did they get that number from? Okay? So this would be less defined of a border than this one. It's invading the local tissues around it, which you can kind of appreciate. That's why it's got sort of these spider-like projections. And if you look at the histology, if you get a biopsy and then you look at the histology, you would see that it's actually fairly poorly differentiated. Meaning this does not really look like smooth muscle that you would expect in the muscle wall of the uterus. This actually looks very cancerous, ill-defined borders, unorganized, it no longer looks like smooth muscle. You've got an area of necrosis or necrotic core. That's a very indicative sign that the tissue is growing faster than the blood supply can even generate. And so as the tissue continues to enlarge, if the blood supply doesn't keep up, then it develops what we call a necrotic core. And so for a lot of malignant tumors, it's very common for them to have a center core that's actually dead tissue. Metastasis is possible and also very likely, and we do call this cancer. So benign versus malignant. In the back.
Why does it form the spider-like projections?
That's just the sort of artist representation of trying to show you that it doesn't have a nice rounded edge like this one does. So this one's going to go out. It may not kind of be spidery like. It might just be sort of one branch that comes off. The idea is that tissue is spreading. That's what they're trying to artistically represent, is the tissue is spreading beyond its localized area.
It's compressing against the other tissue.
It's compressing against the other tissue. It's going to actually digest the base of the membrane and the nearby tissue because it's going to release enzymes like matrix metalloproteases that come in and digest away collagen and elastin and fibronectin, and that's how it actually spreads. And that's a particular mutation in itself. We'll talk about that. So if we move on with some of our terminology, neoplasia, new growth, these neoplastic cells that we see, we use this terminology that says they're transformed. Transform is a word that actually means change, right? So if you're transformed from one shape or one form to another, that would be a correct usage of the word transform. So they replicate outside or ignoring the typical regulatory signals that come from the cell cycle. And so they're transformed because they basically are disobeying them. They're not, you know, the cell, the tissue around that cell is not saying you should divide because none of the other tissues are dividing. And the uterine wall, the only time that there would be dividing taking place would be the endometrial lining, the inner lining during the menstrual cycle. But the smooth muscle wall of the uterus shouldn't be growing or dividing unless there was a implantation of an embryo. Okay? So this is outside of normal control, so they're considered to be transformed. Here's a picture of what some of you may see in your future dental careers, right? This is an oral neoplasm that's growing on the side of the mouth, the cheek. If we look at some other terminology, we like to name these structures or these types of cancers based on the tissue of origin or where they come from. And so we see kind of different examples that are being shown on this slide. Let's go over them. So the carcinoma is typically epithelial, transformed epithelial cells like skin or other epithelial borders like in the gut or in the lungs. Different types of carcinomas. or in the esophagus, like we talked about, there's an adenocarcinoma, because it was the epithelium that was being influenced. The upper right is a picture of squamous skin carcinoma. An adenocarcinoma, this is usually epithelial tissue, but of glandular tissue. An adenocarcinoma, glandular tissue. So like, for example, the adenocarcinoma, the adeno part of our Barrett esophagus outcome is because the tissue became gland-like, because it developed goblet cells that are secreting substance, mucus, right? So it wouldn't be correct to just leave it as a carcinoma in the example of that Barrett esophagus progression, because now they're starting to behave like glandular type of tissue. But the prostate, a lot of the lesions within the prostate are considered adenocarcinomas. And as a result, we see sort of that prostatic type of glandular tissue looking very much like what we see with adenocarcinomas in the esophagus. The bottom left image is an adenocarcinoma of the prostate. And you've got, this is H&E staining. You can see that these are more normal type of glandular cells in the middle of the prostate. And over here, you see how much additional cells have showed up on these structures right here that should look more like these guys. You guys appreciate that? So all of these prostatic glands are growing out of control and dividing beyond what they really should look like down the center. Adenocarcinoma. A sarcoma are transformed connective tissue cells, and they're usually consisting from the embryonic mesoderm, or the middle layer of the mesoderm. The leukemia, don't have a picture of sarcoma here. Leukemia, this is a cancer of the blood or the bone marrow. So a lot of blood types of cancers, and that's the smear, the blood smear that you see right beneath the nose picture. This is a leukemia where you're seeing white blood cells that are being mutated. Last one on the list for today is a lymphoma. In a lymphoma, what do you guys think? Where would you see this cancer mass existing?
Nodes.
In the lymphatic circulation. Lymph nodes, lymph tissue, lymph glands. Right? And this is a picture on the lower right of a patient's lymphoma that's targeting this individual's right arm. Okay, it looks like, you know, the lower leg with a hand attached to it, doesn't it? Back of the lower leg looks like a calf muscle. So this is a tumor that's developed in the lymphatic circulation of this patient's right arm, lymphomas. The last term on this list is sort of a special case, carcinoma in situ. A carcinoma in situ, that's abbreviated CIS, is an early form or an early type of cancer that's defined by the absence or the lack of presence of tumor cells that are invaded. And it usually forms before there's membrane penetration. So a carcinoma in situ is kind of like that transition zone between benign over to malignant. So it's a carcinoma that's in location or in situ. It hasn't yet metastatically broke out, divided, and moved on, but it's probably moments away from doing that. So it's a little bit more of a clinical terminology that kind of tells you, we think this carcinoma in situ or the CIS should be removed because we're a little nervous about it. It might actually start becoming malignant, and we should actually act now versus wait. Okay? So another picture for you. This is a benign glandular tumor or an adenoma that's in the colon. These are colonic polyps. So when you're a male of 50 years or older of age, you're going to have to start going into annual colonoscopies, okay? And what they're looking for is of the intestinal lining, normal intestinal lining, and you see that this is a growth, and we call it a polyp because of its appearance, and it's glandular in appearance, and it's projecting into the lumen. This is the lumen, the white space of the large intestine, and it's still attached. And so if there's polyps that exist in patients, many times what they'll do is they'll remove them, because the concern is that these polyps could actually become malignant, and if they become invasive, they can invade and cause colon cancer, right? And so this is what this would look like on a colonoscopy. You would see, obviously this is histology, you wouldn't see this, but you would see projections that are coming into the lumen extending that might be questionable. And so there's a biopsy type of device that can grab some of those polyps as they trim them off, and they band up or cauterize the tissue below it to keep it from bleeding. Now, of course, there's some bleeding, can't be zero. And then they do histology to determine, are they worried about the polyps that they saw? And should they go back in and remove more of them? Or should we just continue to watch them? And they'll base this off of the histology. So this is a benign example. This one would be one that maybe they would just say, you know what, good thing we have on an annual recall. Next year we're going to probably take out more of them and we'll keep looking at them. But right now, how do you know that it's benign? Well, you see that there's integrity of the basement membrane. This is the basement membrane right here. You know that this would be malignant when you start seeing cells invading and breaking into the underlying tissue, and this is where it becomes concerning. Okay, question in the back.
Is there any correlation with diverticulums and polyps?
So diverticulitis, there is evidence to suggest that patients that are more prone and have higher incidence of diverticulitis. Does everybody know what diverticulitis is? Okay, so you know there's these natural folds within the intestinal tissue. And in some patients, those folds are a lot more aggressive. And as those folds dive down, there could be chyme, right, processed food, as it's flowing through, it kind of gets trapped and stays there for long periods of time. And it can become inflamed and irritated. And so if there's inflammation chronically to that intestinal lining, there may be the development of a mutation due to the inflammation event. So persistent chronic diverticulitis is something that you don't want to leave untreated, and that's why you know you want patients to kind of be paying attention to it. Answer your question? So is there a cause and effect? Like if you have patients that are prone to diverticulitis, does it mean they're going to get colon cancer? No, that's not what I said. But for example, here's another one. If you smoke for 40 years, does it mean you're going to get lung cancer? No. Does it increase your chance? Yes. Okay. That's been pretty well established. Nobody seems to argue with that anymore. Okay. Even the tobacco companies seem to finally say, fine. Okay. You guys win. So there is definitely a correlation. And we know with cigarette smoke, we understand what's going on there. And it's a little premature because we're not in the respiratory section. We'll talk about, you know, vaping. We get to the respiratory section. And right now, the social norm is accepting or thinking that using vaporizers or vaping is actually a safe alternative to cigarette smoke. And actually, that's a very premature conclusion. So we are not yet comfortable, we being the FDA, is not yet comfortable saying that. Okay. And remember, there was a time where smokeless tobacco, chewing tobacco, was termed to be a safe alternative to smoking, right? It's like, sure, you're not going to, you know, have the same effects with the lung, but you have effects in other areas that actually might even be worse in some cases. So do we know what the long-term effects of vaping look like? No, because it's actually fairly new. You know, there weren't like vape stores in Flagstaff 5 years ago. I mean, now they're like all over the place, right? So I think the jury's a little out still, so I wouldn't rush to that conclusion that that's a safe alternative. Okay, moving on. How do cells become cancerous? We're not going to talk about all the mechanisms. I'm not going to explain everything. I don't know everything. Cancer is not an area of my expertise. Okay? I mean, I've learned enough to be able to talk competently in this class at this level and answer a handful of questions. But this is not what the research is in my lab. We don't focus on cancer. But we don't focus on lots of different things that we talk about in this particular class. Okay? But we do know, what we do understand is about this transformation that takes place. And the genetics that I'm going to describe are going to be very, very basic genetics, but I think we'll all probably understand how this works. Because it's based on a 181, 182 exposure of genetics. It's not based on an upper division genetics course. Okay, that would be outside the realm of necessary for this class. But some things you do need to basically understand that 181 and 182 did not really describe is this idea of contact inhibition. So if I take samples of cells, we do this in my lab quite regularly. If I take samples from you, I mean, I don't get samples from students, but we could if you wanted to, don't, you know, drop them all under the door or something like that. And if we take samples from patients and we culture them in a petri dish, okay, then we see that they'll grow in that dish to a certain point and then they stop growing. And we call that contact inhibition. So the analogy is, wouldn't it be great if you could develop a type of seed, grass seed, that would grow to the border edges of your lawn and then stop growing? And just really fill in the middle, but you didn't have to have a weed whacker. You understand what I mean? It's always fun to mow the lawn. It really sucks to use the weed whacker. Okay? So cells in the body actually do that. They grow to a border and stop growing. It's called contact inhibition. Mutated cells, cells that are cancerous, will grow to the edge, and then they will start growing on top of themselves. And they lose contact inhibition. And this transformation that takes place develops a multi-layer of uninhibited, meaning uninhibited growth of cancer cells. And they start growing on top of each other. And we see that with very common cancer type of lines. We see them with HeLa cell lines, which is a cervical cancer line. We see them with Hockett cell lines, which is a keratinocyte cell line. So this is a very basic understanding. All of the other cells in our body, including stem cells, will grow to an edge and stop growing. Okay. Also, what they do is when they get close to the edge, they actually start slowing down their growth. It's kind of like they see the wall is coming and they start putting on the brake. Okay. Well, these cells that grow this way are considered transformed. They're considered autonomous because they're behaving on their own. And these genetics are telling these cells pause replication. This is our gap 1, gap 2, M, and S phase of the cell cycle. And as they see that the edge is coming, the feedback back to the cell is, let's pause replication. We shouldn't be dividing anymore. We're done. These cells here are anchorage independent, meaning that they don't need to sit down on the bottom of the dish. And that's one of the basic concepts of the cells in our body. They like to grow anchored to some structure. And cancer cells will grow unanchored. In fact, there's a in vitro cell prep where you grow cancer cells and you try to create a ball. And so what you do is you grow them in a dish and then you invert the dish upside down. And so they grow kind of in this spheroid, kind of like this teardrop that's coming down and it starts growing into this ball of cancerous mass. Okay, so it's an inverted hanging drop method. These cells are considered to be immortal. Well, what does that mean? That's kind of a weird word to use. Well, so the word immortal, as it's used here, means that all of our cells have a definitive lifespan of which they're able to replicate. And we also know that when we take cells from any organism and we grow them in a petri dish in the laboratory, the number of generations of replication that you can get out of each cell has a very defined window. So for example, if we took biopsy from skin and we got fibroblasts from all of us in the room, my cells would probably poop out after about 9 to 10 cell divisions. And they would stop dividing. Yours, being younger, would probably go maybe to 14 to 18 cell cycles, and then they would stop. Okay? If I got a biopsy from a 75-year-old, then they would only go maybe 5 or 6 cell divisions, and then they would sort of just stop the bite. They wouldn't have any more energy to do anything. Interesting, right? There's an age dependence here. Now, that's exaggerated outside the body because it's artificial. Inside the body, it still exists at some level, but we have adult stem cells in the dermis, right? We have a stratum of cellulae that gives us a new population of cells. But of course, those adult stem cells also have a definitive lifespan, right? And mine are older than yours. So this immortality means that these cells stop losing their ability to divide. In the 1950s, one of the first popularized cancer lines came from a patient known as Henrietta Lacks. Okay? Henrietta Lacks was a woman who was suffering from cervical cancer. And she died, passed away, and her physician, in all his infinite wisdom, decided to keep some of her cells growing, to study them. Well, those cells became very interesting because they never stopped dividing. He'd freeze them, he'd pull them out years later, they'd keep going. You know, they would have generation after generation, they were immortal. They never had a termination of when they could divide. He sent them to some of his colleagues, and now those Henrietta Lacks cells are called the HeLa cell line. And there was a monster lawsuit by the Lacks family against the Supreme Court of California. And the Supreme Court of California decided, in their infinite wisdom, that once your cells leave your body, they no longer belong to you. And so the family was not allowed to have access to any of the monetary rewards or any of the developments that came out of Henrietta Lacks's cell lines. So this wasn't to, you know, make you upset about the legal system or anything, but just to tell the story that we've been playing with these immortal cells. And if you have ever read anything about HeLa cells, you're reading about cancer cell lines from like 60 years ago. And it's the same cells. That's a great immortal story because Henrietta Lacks has passed, right? But her cells have not. They outlived her. Okay? So immortal means they have the ability to continue to divide even beyond what normal cells would be doing. Now, two terms that I want to clearly define: anaplasia and pleomorphic. Anaplasia, by definition, is a term that means there's a loss of organization of the cell, and there's an increase in the size of the nucleus. Now, the second word, pleomorphic, means, by definition, there is a variable nature to the size and the shape of the cell. So the size of the cell might get bigger. We're not talking about the nucleus now. We're talking about the cell itself. The cell gets bigger, and the shape is altered. Instead of round, it's more like, you know, maybe spindle-like. So anaplasia, meaning a loss of organization, it doesn't look like the normal cell. An increase in the nucleus, so the nucleus gets big in relation to the cell cytoplasm. I'll show you examples. It's very common to see cancer cells exhibit both anaplasia and pleomorphism at the same time. But I don't want you to miss on the exam terminology. Anaplasia means one thing, pleomorphism means a different thing. You with me? So don't get caught by the A and B options. Make sure you're only defining, if you're asked only to define one, you're only defining one. Okay? How do these cells become immortal? So I get it. We have these Henrietta Lacks cell lines that are still living. She's passed on from cervical cancer. And her cells are continuing to divide. So how does this, how do you explain this? Well, this is this concept of immortality, right? So this is not some, you know, weird vampire werewolf thing. It is kind of strange in the concept of Henrietta Lacks' cervical cells, or they're really not cervical cells anymore, are still dividing today in laboratories across the world. And I'm not sure if she was cremated or if she was buried, but she has been gone for decades. Well, so if we look at cells, we look at different types of cells, we can see that there are the number of cell divisions that are defined. And once they're over, the cell hits what we call growth arrest. It no longer continues to divide. And then we can see on the y-axis something known as a telomere. And the telomere is a piece of DNA. It's a piece of DNA that is like a TTAGGG repeat. Okay, so it's a set. Is it critical that you remember which nucleotides? No. Okay, but it's a piece of DNA that acts kind of like a bumper, and it's added to the 3' end of the DNA, and this is in what we call the telomere region. And every time replication takes place, that telomere gets a little shorter. And then there's an enzyme known as telomerase that adds additional repeats to the end. Telomerase is an enzyme because it ends in ASE, right? Telomerase. It's an enzyme that adds telomere length to the DNA. It extends that DNA bumper. Because replicating DNA, if you remember back to 181, 182, it's pretty aggressive, right? There's this unzipping that takes place, right? I mean, in all of the videos, everything looks all smooth and, you know, even though there's like classical music playing. I think it's like, you know, punk metal rock that plays, okay? And there's just like shearing that takes place as you pull apart, right? Have you ever, like, this is a funny story, but there's lots of bugs in our yard, right? And a lot of times, certain times of the year, the bugs like to get on each other's backs, which is weird. Okay? And so, Dad, the bugs are on each other's back. Give them a little privacy. Okay? But sometimes when the boy neighborhood kids come over, they love the idea of ripping apart the bugs that are on each other's backs, right? And so this is actually pretty messed up, right? So I told them that would cause damage to the bugs, right? And that we shouldn't, it might actually kill them. You should just let them be giving piggybacks to each other, okay? So if you can imagine ripping these two bugs apart, and if you guys don't understand what is happening, then come see me after class. And you should probably go back to 181 and 182. That is definitely evidence that you need to retake those classes if you have no idea what we're talking about, okay? But this would be, I think, analogous to that, is the DNA pulling apart is an aggressive process. And so there are these bumpers on the end that preserve the integrity of the DNA, and they actually get nicked and shortened every time replication takes place. So telomerase lengthens that. What also is interesting is our telomerase activity declines as we get older. So the ability for us to lengthen the telomeres becomes compromised as we age. Another interesting fact, in cancer cells, telomerase activity goes up. And it's extremely high. It's one of the markers that we use to evaluate if a tissue is a cancerous tissue, is to measure the telomerase levels within that tissue. So if you, by nature, or by definition, if you increase telomerase activity, then you allow for growth arrest to move beyond. So here's a normal cell. Normal cells get to a certain point and their telomere length is so short that they stop dividing. Now our germline, the telomere length is actually preserved. This would be like our canons. That's actually important because you want, for propagation of the species, you want the gametes to actually have preservation of the DNA. Okay? Now this isn't indefinite. It eventually will start to fade down. And that's why you see sort of compromised DNA within gametes of older individuals, right? But the design is wired in the sense that there's a certain point at which men and women are stop being capable of actually replication. And that probably matches about where the telomere length or the danger of the gametes being compromised is too high. And so menopause happens in the female, and the equivalent in males will take place where sperm production goes down. Okay? At the level of our stem cells, you can see they decline to a greater rate than the germ cell lines, but not nearly to the same extent as the normal cells. And that's why even as we're 50, 60, 70 years of age, if you have a cut, you can still heal the cut with adult stem cells in the stratum the solid layer of the integument giving new skin. But you also know clinically that the rate at which a 70-year-old is going to heal that cut is not nearly as fast as a 10-year-old patient, right? Presumably because these stem cells are actually slower. They're working slower. They're not dividing at the same level. Well, what happens with cancer cells is you get an increase in telomere length. And that is what allows them to become immortal. Okay, this was a publication in a super highly regarded science tier one journal, Coffee Table Science, right? Time Magazine. But I was drawn to the cover, right? The year at which we become immortal. And I think it's still fun. We seem to play around with this idea again and again and again within science and society. And has anybody seen the more recent Terminator, the Genesis? Has anybody seen this movie? Right? So Genesis is like this operating system, right? And their sort of mock of society is that there's this countdown. It's not a spoiler alert, but you should watch. It's quite fascinating. And if you don't remember the original Terminator movies because you're too young, the former governor of California was the original Terminator, right? And he was like awesome in this original play. But the bad guy is this organization known as Skynet. Okay, you guys have heard of Skynet? So the joke is always, you know, Skynet's going to take over the world. Well, the name of Skynet is this Genesis, which is like this new operating system that's going to integrate. It sounds super hilarious because it sounds like it could be real. That's why I like it. Is it like integrate your phone with your computer, with your bank accounts, with, you know, it just makes life simpler, right? Your tablet talks to your phone, which talks to your car, and there's like this countdown on everybody's device of when Genesis is going to go live. That's Skynet going live, right? And so this whole idea is the machines take over and they're basically immortal. And so we've been playing with this concept in science fiction, right? But this article was talking about actually how integration, there's a number of different articles that were all in this Time Magazine story. This is back in February of 2011, so it's like 4 years old. But the one that was really interesting wasn't so much this integration of man into machinery, kind of like the Matrix movies. You guys remember the old Matrix movies? It was more on this idea about what's going on that fascinated me with telomerase. And so this guy looks like he's from Flagstaff, but he's not. he doesn't teach like in another department, but it looks like he's good. That's pretty epic. I mean, I don't know if it would get, I could quite do that, but that would be pretty, I think I'd get sick of it after a while. But he rocks it pretty well. So this researcher, I'm going to read this to you. This researcher, and I went to the publication, so I'm going to read you two in the box here. It says, so it wasn't so much the Time Magazine. I was reading, I was fascinated by the picture, and they're talking about immortality of man, and then they had this story that related to a Nature publication. Now, Nature is actually a real science journal. It's actually one of the best, right? It's the Tier 1 journal, peer-reviewed journal. And they were doing a little blurb on what was published in this Nature publication. So it says, every time a cell divides, its telomeres get shorter. And once a cell runs out of telomeres, it can't reproduce anymore and dies. I was like, wow, they actually got that right. I'm going to keep reading. But there's an enzyme called telomerase. I was like,
They actually called it the right thing. That reverses this process. It's one of the reasons cancer cells live so long, which is true. They didn't really explain it, but they're right, okay? It's one of the reasons cancer cells live so long. So why not treat regular non-cancerous cells with telomerase? This is the fountain of youth exploration, right? In November, so this is November of 2010. So now it's like about 5 years ago. Researchers at Harvard Medical School announced in Nature, that's the name of the journal that they published this in, they had done just that. They administered telomerase to a group of mice suffering from age-related degeneration. The damage went away. The mice didn't just get better. They actually got younger. And younger based upon functionality, not like, you know, a Benjamin Button type of movie. So an interesting perspective of how we could leverage telomerase therapeutically. And there's been lots of research that's tried to look at doing this again and again. You have to be careful. I mean, we've cured amazing types of things in mice that never seem to translate into human clinical populations. Okay, so why 5 years later, you know, are old people still getting old? I mean, why haven't we solved this problem? Well, there's obviously more going on mechanistically than what we understand. Now, a little different angle. You're playing the physician here. You just told your patient that they have a lipoma. They expressed concern because their sister was recently diagnosed with a liposarcoma, and it sounds like he has the same thing. So what do you tell your patient to calm them down? Basically what I'm saying is, what's the difference between a lipoma and a liposarcoma? Yes? The lipoma typically, when it ends in an OMA, it usually is an indicator that it's a benign lesion. The suffix of sarcoma is usually more scary. Okay, S, scary. So that's how I remember that. Now, unfortunately, this nomenclature, because, you know, physicians, like, they do whatever they want. They don't necessarily listen to the academics all the time. So some of the nomenclature is actually deviated from. So you very much might find in your family there are examples of omas that, in fact, they are worried about them being cancerous. Now the question is it a lipoma or an oma that's like a carcinoma in situ that's right on the edge of maybe becoming cancerous? And so that's where these, you know, borders of these definitions kind of break down. See, that's where you would ask more questions. But generally speaking, if it ends in OMA, it's usually something that we're a little less worried about. And if it ends in the sarcoma, we're obviously much more concerned. Some histology going back to anaplasia and pleomorphic. And this is where I'm going to use some examples and try to characterize, you know, how you might expect to see them on the exam. The top picture, what tissue is that? Does anybody know what tissue this is? Skeletal muscle, very good. Nicely done. How do you know? You can see the muscle cells, right? The myocyte. You can see that it's not fat because it actually has a cytoplasm to it, right? Fat cell, adipose tissue would actually be vacuole space, white open space in the middle. So these are actually muscle fibers, individual cells, and they're long, so they're coming out at you. Now this is also, or was, skeletal muscle in the bottom picture. Okay, looks a little different, doesn't it? So normal skeletal muscle in cross-section up top, an anaplastic tumor of skeletal muscle down low. This picture down low is called a rhabdomyosarcoma. R-H-A-B-D-O, rhabdo, myo, M-Y-O for muscle, sarcoma, S-A-R-C-O-M-A. Now, what are some of the things that you notice right off the bat? Can I define, use the terminology, pretend you're the physician, you're going to talk super intelligent. Somebody give me an example of how you would explain to me using these terms, and I've given you the definitions right here. What's going on here? Anybody want to take a stab at it? back here. Greg.
The nucleus is larger.
Okay. The nucleus is larger. So this would be an example of what? Enlarged nucleus, right? So this tissue is exhibiting evidence of anaplasia. Right? What else? Someone else? What else do you see? What's that? The tissue is what? Pleomorphic. Down here, right? Why? Because you see large cells, you see smaller cells, medium-sized cells. So you have a variable size. How about variable shape? Well, absolutely. This one's more round. This one's more elongated. These are all pretty much the same size and shape. Wouldn't you agree? I mean, sure, this one looks a little smaller than this one, but compared to the difference here. But we also see, look at how big this nucleus is. You guys see this nucleus? I'm surprised nobody picked up on that. Look how big this one is, right? Look at the nuclei. These are the same magnification, by the way. Look at the nuclei up here. Really small in comparison to this. So here in this rhabdomyosarcoma, you're seeing both anaplasia and you're seeing pleomorphism. But I want you to be able to understand which definition is referring to variable shape and size and which one's actually referring to this loss of organization and the law, or the increase in the nucleus size. Yes?
Does the cells on the far right have multiple nuclei in it?
Yes, yes, yes. This one actually has multiple nuclei. That's absolutely correct. Okay, as does this one right here. As does this one, right? So you're having nuclear divisions, which is, that would be evidence that you have something that's actually rather concerning, right? Because now what you have is you have nuclear replication taking place within the tissue. This is a very aggressively moving cancer now.
That never happens, like, in normal cells, ever?
No, the only time you see this normally would be in inflammatory process. You guys remember back to the foreign body giant cells that we looked at? So foreign body giant cells are one example where you have multi-nucleated cells because you get the fusion of many macrophages. But with an inflammatory process, you wouldn't see variable cell size, you wouldn't see this complete loss of organization taking place. The other place you would see this multinucleated cell normally would be with osteoclasts. You guys remember osteoclasts? Mm-hmm. Osteoclasts are also multinucleated. Those are the only two examples I can think of off the top of my head. So, I mean, it does occur, it's much more unusual. I thought there was another hand somewhere. Yes? It is multinucleated normally, but the nuclei itself here are actually enlarged, and you typically don't see this many nuclei within one particular cell. Okay, so skeletal muscle is multinucleated, but not to the same density as what you're seeing here. And you can see that up here, like this cell right here has a nucleus here and one over here, right? This cell right here has a nucleus here and one over here. So, I mean, this one has a nucleus here, right? So it's not just that there are a couple. There's actually, and they're enlarging, which suggests that the nuclear material is increasing. So another tool that we use clinically is our tumor markers. Tumor markers. And we're going to take a break after the tumor markers. So hang in there, because we'll take a break. But I really want to make sure that you guys understand this, because this, for some reason, seems to be a confusing topic. These tumor markers, I changed the slide on one and not the other. These tumor markers, we find them all throughout the body. So we're going to find them on plasma membrane. That's what TM stands for. We're going to find them circulating in the blood. We can find them even in spinal fluid. We can find them in the urine. Take a urine sample and look at different types of markers. Because these markers are markers that are typically normally occurring. Most oftentimes, they're markers that are normally found in tissue. And in a cancer situation, if the tissue is growing when it's really not supposed to be growing, then you're going to be adding more markers of that plasma membrane per unit volume. Make sense? And that indicates that that particular tissue mass is actually growing and enlarging rather than sort of staying about the same size. You with me? So like if you all of a sudden had a growth kind of starting to grow on the side of your neck, you know, and it got to the point where it started to look less like a nubbin and more like a second head, probably a friend would be like, dude, like there's something growing on the side of your neck, okay? So that's kind of the analogy here, is that these markers are found on tissue, but as the tissue grows, new tissue or more tissue beyond what it's supposed to, the amount of marker presence goes up. So we're going to look at two very specifically, but you can see throughout the entire body some classic examples. Like in lung cancer patients, we look for these surface plasma membrane markers, CA125, CEA. In liver cancer, AFP, prostate, PSA, testicular cancer, AFP, you can also find AFP in liver, HCG, ovarian cancer, CA125 and CEA, which are the same you find in lung, colon, CEA, which is the same you find in lung, as well as in ovarian, pancreatic, so on and so forth, breast cancer, CA125, CEA, and what we call HER2. So focusing on HER2 and PSA. So HER2 stands for human epidermal growth factor receptor 2. Human epidermal growth factor receptor 2. I like this one because it's a great example, female example, and we'll be gender fair and we'll pick on males next. But it's also conveniently called HER, and so that should easy for you to remember. Human epidermal growth factor receptor 2. Now, men have that receptor as well, but obviously the presence of the receptor in females in breast tissue is much higher than it is in males. Now, what ends up happening when a patient has, usually under self-exam or annual checkup, feels a lump in the breast, then they might have a mammogram, there might be confirmation that there's some strange-looking tissue, or there's a possibility of maybe some density to this tissue that's concerning. So I think we should go in with a biopsy, and let's take a sample, and then we'll run histology. Okay. So it's usually a breast exam, self-exam, or annual exam on the palpation. They feel a lump or something that feels different than it normally does. Then it's a mammogram. Okay, using x-ray technology, and then next up is breast biopsy. Okay, breast biopsy comes back, and what do they look for? Well, they'll look histologically, does the breast tissue look like it should? Well, what they can also do is they can stain for HER2. And if the HER2 levels are really, really high, that suggests that that breast tissue is actually replicated beyond what it really should do. Now, if you're capturing a young woman in adolescence, you're going to see a natural increase in HER2 as the breast mass increases. But if you're capturing a woman past adolescence, that HER2 presence should be fairly consistent. Okay? So HER2, human epidermal growth factor receptor 2, levels are pretty well defined in women based upon their age. Okay? That's how we use biopsy tissue. Now, let's take a look at prostate-specific antigen, PSA. So PSA is circulating within the blood. So the prostate makes an antigen, a protein, as a product of prostate production of fluid, prostatic fluid, and some of that antigen makes it into the blood and circulates around. And so it's very normal for men to have a very low basal level of prostate-specific antigen, or PSA. But what ends up happening when the prostate is cancerous is the prostate enlarges, And as it adds additional mass, as it enlarges, it starts producing more PSA. So PSA levels in the blood start to rise beyond what they should really be, and that's where, you know, if your dad or your grandfather or an older friend, usually it's older men, and say, you know, I had a checkup, they checked my PSA levels, they're a little nervous, they seem a little high, higher than they're supposed to be. I'm supposed to come back in 3 months, you know, do another blood test. So that's what's going on there. Now, here's the challenge, mostly for men. With PSA, the challenge is, there's two challenges. Number one, women are a little bit better clinically about going in routinely to the doctor, okay? Men aren't as great. So, if you're a 50-plus-year-old male, and you know you only see the doctor when, like, you cut a limb off, or if you know your heart stops or your breathing is not continuing, then you're not going to have data on your PSA levels as you get older. And as men get older, the prostate actually naturally enlarges. So if we have age on this graph, and this is for PSA only, okay? And we have PSA levels here, relative levels. And we look at 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, and 70, right? So PSA levels are gonna kinda do something like this, okay? They kinda do something like this as men get older. So as men get older, there's also, it's more common as the prostate enlarges, it puts pressure on the bladder. And so you know that an older individual, an older man is having natural or prostate enlargement because they're usually up more frequently at night to go to the bathroom, right? Men also can't hold pee very well at all. I know that because on road trips, it's always me that has to pull over. Everybody else in my house is a female, and so I really do. Sorry, now I gotta pee. So as men get older, they have to go to the bathroom more frequently during the night. Now, if there's prostate cancer, that's actually, that you might even see an increase in that activity. Like, they're getting up maybe every 2 hours to have to go to the bathroom, just because it wakes them up, okay? So the problem is, if this is sort of normal PSA progression, how do you know when you're 70, if your levels are here, if, you know, if this is you, how do you know if this is just normal deviation for you and the curve that you're on, or, you know, is this really a spike because of a lesion in the prostate? Okay, so it's one of the reasons that, you know, sort of this, you're starting to see this become a lot more popular, where we're starting to publicly let folks know, hey, if you're of this age, you need to start doing routine annual physicals for this, right? And for women, especially if there's a history of breast cancer, it's becoming earlier and earlier, right, of trying to get those mammograms on an annual basis to see what's going on. Same thing with men for prostate checkups, as well as colon cancer, okay, colonoscopies. So the point here, the last little point, we'll go to our break, is the uses of monitoring these tumor markers. First, you have to understand how they work, otherwise you can't use them effectively. Number two, you can screen patients, but you can also help to use them as a diagnosis, which is a little bit more less invasive in some cases. And you can also track disease progression. So you can actually look to see if somebody is responding to chemotherapy and coming back to a different curve with treatment. And that might be that, okay, the size of the prostate is shrinking, the amount of PSA that's being released is actually coming down. Make sense? Okay. Let's take a break, and we'll pick it up right here.